السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، thank you for joining us, those of you who are online and those who are physically here in the masjid. This place is packed. It is standing room only. I'm just kidding. There's literally two people in the room. Subhanallah. Excellent. So as you know, we're going to be talking about the signs before the Day of Judgment, because, what can I say, so many annoying things. Like, I'll get this email about how, or these WhatsApp messages about how someone saw this dream, and the dream was the virus came to him and it said, I am going to kill a billion people and I will spare the believers. Like, that doesn't even make sense, that the virus, have you ever heard in human history of a virus that just affected non-believers and never infected the Muslims? Have you ever heard of that? You know, we're going to talk about the plague of Amwas, and some of the great companions were infected and they died. Like, have you ever heard of a disease that only affects non-Muslims? And then all these messages about, oh, because, you know, the areas that we wash for wudu are the areas that you need to keep clean, and because we make wudu five times a day, we're not going to get sick. Well, we already know of Muslims, some of them right here in Houston, who actually, we do know of some Muslims who got sick, and in Seattle, one of the people who died is a Muslim. So, and then it's not going to be a sign, like, before the imam prays over someone, that's how we know if someone is righteous or not. Yeah, if he got sick, that means, oh, he wasn't a believer, because this virus only hits the... Anyways, there's so many of these, they look kind of mysterious and mystical and cryptic. This man saw this dream, and the sheikh interpreted the dream that this virus will kill that many people, and it will mostly affect China and this place and that place. Yeah? Well, you wrote this fake message after you knew the affected countries. You know, if you would have sent this 5 months ago, or maybe 10 months ago, we would have believed. Anyways, so we don't want to keep this too complicated here, but in order to talk about the signs before the Day of Judgment, you really have to talk about some guidelines. Because without the guidelines, anybody can be anybody. I'll give you an example. This happened, I can't remember what's, maybe it was Florida, I can't remember. I was traveling to give a class in that city. I gave the Jum'ah khutbah, and in the Jum'ah khutbah, I mentioned the Mahdi. And unbeknownst to me, the Mahdi was in the audience. So after the salah, this guy came up to me. He said, have you heard of a man, his name is blank blank, I forget the name now. I said, no, I've never heard of him. He said, because he claims to be the Mahdi that's going to come towards the end of time. I said, really? I said, where can I find him? He said, I am he. Now, so now he's the Mahdi, now I'm face to face with the Mahdi. Oh man, I wanted to have some fun with him, but I didn't, because one, he was in his 50s. Two, just about every single person who says they're the Mahdi has something wrong here. There's always some kind of mental problem, because nobody would think they're the Mahdi unless they really have some mental problem. So this guy had some kind of mental problem. That's why I didn't make fun of him. But a number of interesting things, by the way. You know, when you look at the videos of the Haram in Mecca, you always see police officers standing near the Imam. And I used to always think that these police officers are there to guard the Imam, to protect the Imam. And that's part of their job. But another huge part of it, they're actually protecting the microphone. Because people will come and specifically claim to be the Mahdi. Not Isa ibn Maryam or anything, alayhi salatu wasalam. They claim to be the Mahdi. Why? Because in the hadith, the Mahdi emerges and he is given the bay'ah, the pledge at the Kaaba. So everybody who thinks he's the Mahdi says, let me grab the microphone and announce it there. I might get the bay'ah. Anyways, so let's get back to the guy in Florida or wherever he was. So this guy now, he said, I'm the Mahdi. And I'm like, oh, great. So let's test this man. I said, okay. Now, and I'm trying to be very respectful and keep a straight face. I said, you know that the Mahdi, you know, he is of Arab origin, related to the family of the Prophet ﷺ, and his name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah. So he said, yes, that was the original plan, and then Allah saw that the Arabs were not worthy, so he changed the plan. So he gave it to me. And he was from, you know, not to mention But he was like from the islands, you know, Trinidad, Guyana. He was one of those two. All right. Now, so he's saying Allah changed that plan. And so now I'm trying to get him to understand. And that's the point that I'm trying to make now. If I don't have any of these signs and descriptions, if I don't have these guidelines, anyone can claim to be anything. So this man said all the plan changed, meaning his name is not Muhammad ibn Abdullah. He doesn't have this, you know, like large forehead and a nose with like a big nose, you know, with a bridge. He's not related to the Prophet. All these signs are gone now because he said the Arabs aren't worthy. So I'm trying to explain to him nicely. I said, okay, so I'm just a normal Muslim here. And you say you're the Mahdi, and this brother here says he's the Mahdi. What information, what do I have to discern, to be able to tell which one of you is the Mahdi and which one isn't? Like, how do I do that? If all the hadith are cancelled now, how can I tell if I have two people who claim to be the Mahdi, what do I have to use that as judgment? Anyways, of course, he, to make a long story short, did not understand the argument. He said, I just gave you proof that I'm the Mahdi. I said, what was that? He said, I quoted the Quran when I walked up to you. Also, anyone who quotes the Quran is the Mahdi now. Okay, what about this? Let me make this rule simple. I didn't want to jump into the rules right away, but since we're here, imagine someone tells you, you meet someone, you ask him, what's your name? He says, Muhammad ibn Abdullah. That's my name, Muhammad Abdullah. And then he says, pledge to me. Okay, why should I pledge to you? He says, because I'm the Mahdi. The Mahdi's name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Okay, but are there other descriptions of the Mahdi? You have to match all of them. You can't just be Muhammad ibn Abdullah, that means you're the Mahdi. Or somebody comes to you with a large bridge on his nose, and says, look at my nose, now pledge to me. But why should I pledge to you? The Mahdi will have a large nose. So that means pledge to me. But it doesn't work like that. What about the other things? Is your name Muhammad ibn Abdullah for one? Or what if someone comes to you and his name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah and he has a bigger nose and a protruding forehead? Then what? You pledge to him? And that's why it's so important to always cover the rules, the ground rules, before you start speaking about the signs before the Day of Judgment. I want to start off with a hadith in Sahih Muslim. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrates, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best day on which the sun has risen is Friday. خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسِ يَوْمُ الْجُمْعَةِ. The best day the sun has risen is Friday. فِيهِ خُلِقَ آدَمْ. On that day Adam was created. وفيه أدخل الجنة, and he was entered into الجنة on that day. وفيه أخرج منها, and he was also taken out of الجنة on a Friday. And the last hour, يعني the day of judgment, will be on a Friday. So what if, let's say you have a roommate, you wake up Wednesday, you ask him, did you pray Fajr? He tells you no. You say, okay, why didn't you pray Fajr? He says, because I know the day of judgment is not going to be today. Today is Wednesday. The day of judgment, according to the hadith in Sahih Muslim, will be on a Friday. So if it's on a Friday, it's not today, I'm safe. Here you would tell him, don't worry about the big day of judgment, worry about your day of judgment. Because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man mata faqad qamat qiyamatu. Whoever dies, his day of resurrection has already started. So you're worried about your day of resurrection. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would shift people's attention sometimes from trying to talk about when the last day will be. Yani, if somebody, look at this in Sahih Bukhari, a man asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the day of judgment. He said, when, ya Rasulullah, mata sa'a, when will the hour be? Now, he lives, you know, thousands of years before the day of judgment, and he's not going to be alive when the big day of judgment happens. So, even, and the Prophet doesn't even know the date, but suppose he knew it and told it to him, would he benefit from it? So that's why, that's not your concern here. The Prophet shifted his concern to something more beneficial. And he says, وَيْحَكْ مَاذَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا. He said, may Allah have mercy on you, the equivalent of that. What have you prepared for it? That's the big deal. If you know what day the day of judgment will be, it doesn't benefit you. What benefits you now is how do you prepare for it? And the fact that your day of judgment can begin at any time, that is really your concern. And that's why it's interesting. In one narration, the companion said the Prophet ﷺ would talk about the Dajjal so much that we'd think he's hiding right behind those trees. Prophet ﷺ would speak about the Dajjal so much that we think he's coming right out of those trees, he's hiding right there. And then another time, the Nabi ﷺ came out and he found the companion sitting talking about the Dajjal. And then he tells them, should I tell you of something that I'm more concerned for you than the Dajjal? Al-shirk al-khafi, and hidden shirk. It's when someone shows off or does an act of worship to show off to people, not to Allah Azza wa Jal. So look at what the balance here. Sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would talk about it like it's right there. And then the next time he wants your focus not to be something that you probably will not encounter, but to focus on something that will affect you and your life. Okay. The first and most important thing. Now, we're going to talk about the minor and major signs. And I'm going to talk about just maybe a few of the minor signs and use them primarily in examples. And then we're really going to be focusing on the major signs before the Day of Judgment. And for those who wanted something on a lighter note, look, some people are saying these are the ends of times, or this is the end of the world, or, you know, Mahdi is going to show up any minute. The Mahdi is always going to show up at any minute. And every generation always believed, or many generations believed that the Mahdi is going to show up in their times. There was one of the scholars, and this is hundreds of years before us, he was certain that the Mahdi will show up during his time, and he used to tell his students, when you see the Mahdi, tell him, I said, Assalamu alaikum. Yani, I know that if Mahdi might come in my lifetime, if I die, he will certainly come in your lifetime. If you see him, give him salams. And this was hundreds of years ago. We know people today who believe, and I'm talking about legitimate, yani, knowledgeable students of knowledge, who believe the Mahdi will show up at our times. Or the Dajjal will show up at our times. But there's many things that happen before the Dajjal shows up. And many of them have not happened, actually almost all of them have not happened. And things that happened before the Mahdi shows up, and they haven't happened either. So when someone tells you that the Dajjal is going to be here 2 days from now, or the Mahdi is stuck in traffic but he's going to be here any minute, just don't believe him. Alright, so what we have to do with the signs of the hour, the major and minor signs, and I'm going to explain in a little bit the difference between the two. Number one, you have to believe all the signs, as long as they're from an authentic source, meaning they're from the Quran or from the authentic sunnah, then you have to believe. That's your only obligation. The fact that I believe something doesn't mean I have to know the inner workings of it and I have to explain it to everybody. Yani, I believe in the beast. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the dabba. أَخْرَجْنَا لَهُمْ دَابَّةً مِّنَ الْأَرْضِ تُكَلِّمُهُمْ. We brought out a beast from the earth that speaks to people. So that's in the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned it in the authentic hadith. Now, my job is to believe in the emergence of the beast. Now, someone might come to me and say, so you believe, you're Muslim, you believe in that? Okay, now explain to me, what species is it? What is this beast that speaks languages? And how is it under the ground? And where are its parents? And how does it eat? And how long has it been underground? And where is it right now? Why can't we find it? That's not my job. So to make life easy, your job is to believe only, not to have a thorough explanation and give you like what kind of species it's from and give all, you know. So that's not your job. Number one, your job is to believe in that which you understand, and more importantly, to believe in that which you don't understand. Because that's when the real challenge comes. Everybody can believe what they understand, but when you don't understand something, and it's authentic, here, are you going to believe or are you not going to believe? When the sun rises from the west. صح? Sun rises from the west. صح? Yeah. So I got confused for a minute. The sun rises from the east now and sets in the west. But there's going to be a time when the sun will rise from the west. So some people try to explain it and say, okay, when the sun rising from the west, you know, it's not possible that the earth will spin the other way. So the sun rising from the west, meaning the light of Islam growing in the west and rising from the west. Sounds nice, and it sounds promising, but here's a very big problem with it. I'm skipping ahead to the rules. The big problem with it now is that now you're breaking one of the rules. In order for me to say this is that sign, it has to match all the descriptions of the sign. To tell me that The sun rising from the west is Islam growing in the west. Allahu Akbar.
Okay.
But one of the clear things when the sun rises from the west is that Allah does not accept anyone's tawbah anymore. So if Islam is growing in the west, why can't I make tawbah? It doesn't make sense, right? It has to fit. It has to fit all the descriptions. I'm coming back to this in a second. But if you don't understand something, it's not a reason to say it's not authentic or I don't believe it simply because I don't comprehend it. It's the world of the unseen. That's the nature of the world of the unseen. If you could fathom and explain every aspect of it and even see it, then it wouldn't be unseen. Okay, another mistake people make is that they try to interpret every sign according to our present world today. They try to interpret every sign according to our present world. And people are always guilty of that. Let's take some simple examples. So basically, one of the minor signs is that there will be less barakah, less blessing in time. Time passes quickly. Time passes quickly. This is one of the minor signs. Towards the end of time, the time will be passing quickly. So some people said, okay, that means there'll be less barakah in time. Others said the day will get shorter. So it will be the same in hours, but it'll feel shorter. So like I said, time will pass quickly. Now others said, time passing quickly, in the old days, a lot of times they would refer to a distance using time. So they'll say, this person is masirat kada, the distance of 3 days, for example. They used to measure distance by days, by time. So with time now passing quickly, some scholars said that's means of transportation or faster means of transportation. So that what used to take 3 days, the journey of 3 days, now can take you a few hours, or sometimes even less than an hour. If you're on a plane, even on a car, a journey of days on camelback, just a few hours and you're there, and you're back again. So they're saying, look, here time passing quickly can mean faster means of transportation, or it can actually mean less barakah, less blessing in your day, so the hours pass and you don't get much done. The point is that this is a sign that could have been understood one way, and it also could have been understood according to the changes in our times. But not everything has to match our times. I'll give you an example. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned in the hadith that the hour will not be established until predatory animals speak to people. Yani lions, tigers, wolves, predatory animals will speak to people. And it will not be one incident or two, but a number of them. It's a common thing that these animals now are speaking to people. Now here, let's look at the rule we mentioned earlier. What if someone says that's not possible? Animals don't talk and wolves don't talk. Right, slow down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did He not create animals that can speak? And you'll say yes. Not just parrots, there are other kinds of birds that can speak. Okay, so who created this parrot? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this animal able to speak. Alright, can He take an animal that He already created and make it speak? Okay, yes. So that's the first thing. Well, wolves don't speak. Of course wolves don't speak. That's what makes it a sign before the Day of Judgment. When wolves speak, it's a big deal. So that's the first thing the hadith mentions. Then it mentions that a man will talk to the tip of his whip. A man will talk to the tip of his whip. And some argue that the whip will talk back. Because if you just talk to your whip, you're just crazy. There's no sign there. But if your whip talks back to you, then that's an inanimate object speaking, and that's a major sign. And then it says, a man's thigh will inform him of what his family did in his absence. So a man's thigh will inform him of what his family did in his absence. So people in our day and age, when they hear that, what do they understand immediately? Cell phones. Where do you keep your cell phone? Right here in your pocket, which is right near your thigh. And you pick it up and you call your family at home and they tell you what happened while you were gone. So khalas, that's the end of that. Case closed. Okay, but a number of things here. One, it could be the cell phone. But we cannot confirm and write it off as it is the cell phone for sure. Because it could be something else that will happen in the future. Why? Because number one, the man's thigh is placed, like the cell phone is not such a miracle that it would be placed in the same hadith as wolves speaking and inanimate objects speaking, and then you calling your, and it's not even your thigh telling you, really. It's not your thigh telling you what happened. It's your wife herself telling you, or your husband, when you pick up your phone, the device connects you to them and they tell you what happened. So that's not really the same, is it? It's not really the same. So we can't say it is definitely the cell phone. It could be, but it could be something more miraculous, more of a sign before the Day of Judgment that a man's thigh will speak to them. And again, my job is to believe in that. I'm not going to explain to you how it happens. How often does your thigh speak? What if it's talking too much? Hit it, stab it with a pencil. I'm just kidding. All right. Anyways, but people are always guilty of trying to explain things within our world. Like this is, you know, this particular, like there's one hadith that mentioned that that there will be people from my ummah who will go to the masajid riding on chariots, or sometimes described as chairs. So you say, okay, how do you go to the masjid sitting on a chair or on a chariot? And some said, well, I've seen handicapped people go to the masjid on a wheelchair. That's something that 1,400 years ago, you couldn't imagine. Others said, cars, in a car, you're essentially sitting on a chair and it takes you to the masjid. So it could be, but one of the beautiful things about the unseen is that it can always have more than one plausible explanation. All right. I'll give you an example of that. So, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam described a number of scouts that will go to verify certain information. I think we'll get to that later. But the point is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then swears by Allah that he knows their names and the names of their fathers and the colors of their horses. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, and this towards the end of time, that they'll be on horses. And then we see a lot of descriptions of primitive weaponry. The Prophet ﷺ says, Al-Qastantiniyah, Constantinople, will be conquered without firing a single arrow. So people said, aha, he said the arrow. And then he mentioned that when Ya'juj and Ma'juj come out, that yustawqid, yani the believers, will use their min rimahihim, that people will, for many years, use their like spears, the wood from their spears, for fuel, for fire, to light fire in their homes, to cook with. So, okay, so they had spears, arrows in Constantinople, and horses when we were talking about the scouts. So they said that means something will happen and people will go back. No more guns, you know, or airplanes or tanks. They'll go back to horses and spears and swords. Okay. Then they start to speculate here. One famous thing, they say, okay, we're going to run out of oil. When we run out of oil, no more tanks, no more cars, no more planes. So what will happen? You get back on a horse. And they're forgetting about electric cars. You know, they're coming a long way. Ask Tesla. The point is, so they went straight from there's no gas to horse. Type, there's no gas, hybrid, or electric car, hydrogen fuel cell, you know? There's some other things, bicycles. I live in Friendswood, Texas. I'm going to just, if we run out of gas, go buy a horse. I'll use a bicycle for a minute, you know? Anyways, the point is, so they said we run out of fuel and then people go back to, that's one. Two, they said it could be something nuclear and then it wipes out all technology, blah, blah, blah. And then people go back to horses and knives again. There's not a single gun laying around. And I'm sure in Texas there'll be, even if the whole world dies, come to Texas, you'll find guns and bullets, alhamdulillah, right? All right. Then they said maybe it's something like a solar flare. Solar flare from the sun, a huge one. It will knock out any technological or electronic device on Earth. Besides the fact that scientists said there's only a 10% chance of a solar flare doing anything like that. But it doesn't have to be a global catastrophe. The scholars mentioned a very reasonable, very plausible explanations. One, they said that it could be that there are other weapons and advanced technology and what have you, but the terrain allowed these men to be on horseback. There can be a car and you can still be on horseback. There can be a tank and you're still on horseback. One of the examples a scholar mentioned, he said, if you look at the war in Afghanistan, طبعاً when we say the war in Afghanistan, we mean the halal one against the Russians. We don't talk about the one... I'm just kidding. We don't talk about the one when Bush, during his room, we don't know what that was. But it was halal when the Russians were... when people were fighting the Russians. They said if you watch footage of those battles, the Afghans were on horseback and they're fighting an enemy on helicopters and on tanks. Why? Because the terrain, the landscape, allowed them to be on horseback even though the enemy is on machinery. So they said that's another explanation. It doesn't have to be catastrophe, the world starts from zero. And now, of course, some people are probably thinking, aywa, coronavirus kills everybody, then people start fresh. Start fresh with a gun, start fresh with a knife. Anyways, so that's one. The other explanation that scholars mention, they said it could be that they had guns and machine guns and bombs and RPGs. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't. The lesson was not about the weaponry. The lesson was about what will happen. So the Prophet ﷺ skipped that part and he spoke to them in a language that makes sense to them. And the Prophet ﷺ would tell them, not a single arrow was shot. Because they understand the arrows. He will not say, not a single RPG was fired. And they will say, وَقَالُوا وَمَا الْRPG يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ They didn't. Okay. Anyways, get the point. What is beautiful about it is that there isn't just one possible explanation. With the unseen, you will find more than one very plausible explanation. And that brings us to another very important rule. And that is, if you ever are listening to anybody and they tell you for a fact this thing that will happen in the future will take place right here, and he gives you latitude and longitude, and they give you the exact date and time, red flag goes up immediately. Something is wrong when someone is telling you about the unseen, which is unknown, in perfect detail. No matter who that speaker is, someone is telling you the future in detail and telling you this is the only explanation, do not listen to that person. I've seen with my own eyes, I've seen a picture of the barrier of Ya'juj and Ma'juj that broke down. I mean, this guy had a picture of the barrier of Ya'juj and Ma'juj that Dhul Qarnayn built. And it was broken. He said, yes, Ya'juj and Ma'juj, they came out 8 years ago. And they're out. Like, okay, now here's the other, we have to follow the chronology, right? Because of the 10 major signs before the Day of Judgment, we know the last one for sure. And we know the first three, right? We know the first three in order. We know the last one. And then some of the ones in the middle, even in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, whichever comes first. Even Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't know which one comes before the other one. But the chronology, the fact that we do know that when the Al-Mahdi emerges, the Dajjal emerges, they fight a little bit, then Isa Alayhi Salaam comes down, and then he kills the Dajjal, and then before they could do anything, they get news that Ya'juj and Ma'juj have come out. Look at that order, and there's no disputing that order. Then somebody tells you, Ya'juj and Ma'juj broke out and came out 8 years ago. And it was probably 10 years ago now. So okay, what about all the things that happened before? So all that changed now. Which means if Ya'juj and Ma'juj came out, we're either hiding in the mountain with Isa alayhi salam right now and we don't know it, or we are Ya'juj and Ma'juj and we don't know it. It just doesn't make any sense. You have to follow the chronology. So, but I was on another point before. What was I saying before I got to this? I had a point before I jumped to this other point. Too many points here. Anyways, what I was saying is that, so this guy, yeah, I was saying the red flag. Remember, I was saying it's a red flag. I'm just excited about this, about this material. We're saying a red flag is when someone tells you precisely and exactly this is what's going to happen. So this guy had a picture of the barrier of Ya'juj and Ma'juj that broke down. And he'll tell you some certain things by date, this will happen about this time or at this moment. You can't know that. And the minute somebody says, oh, this is the only explanation, it cannot be the only explanation. It's the unseen. And maybe it's not even something that's going to happen during our lifetime. So, you know, that's strike three, you're out. Okay. Next point. The next point is that some, especially when people cannot understand a sign, they say it's figurative. It's not literal. It's figurative. And this is just one of those things that irk you. Every time, oh, this is not figurative. It's not, I mean, it's not literal. It's just, it's figure, and a figure of speech. When you say the Dajjal is not really a person. The Dajjal is a system. The Dajjal is a government. The Dajjal is, but what government, what system? The Prophet ﷺ mentioned his eyes. He mentioned his height. He mentioned his hair. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned his hair. He mentioned his shoulders, his body structure, like, you know, a shoulder, what they look like. He mentioned, you know, his, that on his forehead has the words ka, fa, ra. He mentions that he, you know, will kill a person. He cannot enter Mecca and Medina. So how can you, after all this, tell me this is a system? This is a system. This is not someone, this actual or physical. انتهى الوقت, we're still good. Right? Adhan comes, inshallah. 39, تفضل طيب. We'll stop for the adhan, then we'll have about 15 minutes or so, and then we'll stop.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين أما بعد. Okay, before I continue, a special shout out to Arij, Zaid, and Saif Aidi. Okay, seem to be the only three kids in Southeast Houston watching. Okay, so we're saying that first of all, language is literal. Any language, it's literal. Most of English is literal. When I'm most of conversation. And most of instructions and directions are literal. When if I'm telling you actually, if I tell you, bring that chair, I mean, bring me that chair. I don't mean by chair, he means support, bring me the support. Nobody talks like that, okay? So unless it's clearly, very clearly from the language, figurative, then it's literal. When a Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam speaks about the smoke, he means smoke. All right? And that's the most popular explanation, that he meant smoke. When it's talking about a beast that will come out of the earth, some people said no, because they couldn't understand how a beast comes out of the earth. So they said no, the beast, it's germs. Germs that will come, because the beast in the hadith will mark people on their noses, and their face will be marked believer, disbeliever. So they said it's a germ that comes and it leaves some kind of mark on the face. طيب, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَخْرَجْنَا لَهُمْ دَابَّةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ تُكَلِّمُهُمْ, speaks to them. When's the last time germ spoke to you? Or some kind of disease spoke to you? So, huh? Never, right? So it has to, it can't be just, you take everything as being figurative. The Dajjal is a system, it's a system of government, and so on and so forth. That's also, there's no evidence for that. The Prophet ﷺ describes a man, and he even says that Ibn Qatan, he tells the companions, the man Ibn Qatan looks like him the most. So how can it be not a man at this point? Or the barrier of Ya'juj and Ma'juj is figurative. Okay, you just want it to be figurative. But there's nothing figurative about it. Everything is literal. Read Surah Al-Kahf, everything in it is literal. He said, Atuni Zubar al-Hadid. He said, bring me, he didn't say al-Hadid, Zubar al-Hadid, which means the chunks of metal like this, or iron. And then he melted it. Ufrig alayhi qitra, which is copper. And then the mixture of copper and steel and iron was a known mixture, you know, for extra strength and for to last a long time. And then he said, قَالَ أَنْفُخُ, blow. All this physical description, بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ, and there were many clues there, and Allah Azza wa Jalla didn't say بَيْنَ الْجَبَلَيْنِ, but بَيْنَ السَّدَّيْنِ, and all that to show you that it's physical, there was actual work that was done, fire that was blown, things that were melted. And then after all this, oh, it's just figurative. That's not how it works. And that's why anyone who says, oh, this is figurative, that is figurative, doesn't really understand how the language works. Not just the Arabic language, but how language works. All right. Very good. All right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purposely gave us a lot of details in some places and few details in other places. And He gave us as much detail as we need. For example, the Mahdi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us so much detail so that we can test, put anyone to the test to see if they're the Mahdi or not. Ashley. Adi. Okay, another shout out. Azeem Dixon is also watching. So like four kids now who are watching, mashallah. Inshallah, when this virus blows over, you'll get some kind of prize, okay? Right now, I don't want to give anything out. All right, good job, Azeem. Where's Aisha? Okay, Aisha's there also, great. That's it? All right, no Zaid? Okay, we're saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us some details about certain signs. Like the Mahdi, we have so many details that if anyone says I'm the Mahdi, I can open up the details and say, okay, you don't have this, you don't have this, you don't have this. Sorry, you're not the Mahdi. Because I need to know those details to be able to discern if this is the Mahdi or not. I'll tell you something interesting. After the Mahdi leads that Fajr prayer and Isa alayhi salam prays behind him, there is not a single narration about the Mahdi after that. Nothing. You know why? Because you don't need anything. You don't need to know anything about him after that. The superstar is here. Isa alayhi salam is here. Nobody cares about the Mahdi at that point. You know? I can give analogies. Yani. Like if I'm in the room, then Sheikh Waleed walks in. Khalas, right? Anyways, the point is, then certain signs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purposely gave us very little information. Like the beast. Very little information. Or like how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hid the location of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Because guess what would happen if we knew exactly where Ya'juj and Ma'juj were today? What do you think would happen? We've got to liberate these people. And we're going to go and free them and bring them the internet, throw them an iPhone. Come to our... our great world, you know, leave them alone, because I know you anthropologists trying to free them and give them human rights, they'll give you some rights. Anyways, the point is, you're to take every text literally, except unless there is a reason to explain it otherwise. All right? And that was going to say the companions, when the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the smoke, some of them said the smoke happened because there was this famine. Now, hey, watch this here. He said there was this intense famine in Mecca, and when the person would come out from the fatigue, he would everything would be hazy, and it would be as if there is smoke everywhere, but there wasn't smoke. But others believe the smoke is literal, because the hadith describes when the believer like inhales it or experiences the smoke, he will just get like the sniffles, the runny nose, but the disbeliever will become bloated and their face will become black. So here you see it's something actual and literal. Anyways, in order for us to affirm that this is that sign, it has to fit all the descriptions. I said this earlier with the example of the Mahdi. To tell me you're the Mahdi, you have to fit all the descriptions. Not just يعني أقنى الألف or what do you call it, like an aquiline nose, where the nose with a bridge and a protruding forehead, and his name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah as well, and his lineage can be traced back to the Prophet ﷺ. Is that enough? They're right now on earth, people who have those descriptions. But is that enough? The Mahdi also, the hadith mentions that Allah يُصْلِحُ اللَّهُ فِي لَيْلَةٍ, Allah rectifies him overnight. That means he's just a regular guy, nobody knows who he is, and overnight he's the Mahdi, and everybody recognizes him as the Mahdi. And that's why people pledge to him. And that's why the Prophet said, if you hear of him, if you have to crawl over the snow, crawl over the snow and pledge to him. Now, my friend in Florida, the Mahdi, this guy, he's been telling people he's the Mahdi for 15 years. So I'm like, okay, Allah also changed that plan. And he was, immediately when everyone knows it's the Mahdi, everybody pledges to him. There's another guy, there's a YouTube channel, there's a Mahdi. This guy is from Pakistan. And he has a YouTube channel, okay? And he uploads a video every week or whatever it is. I don't know if he's still going on this channel, but I used to see. It's all in Urdu. But what's interesting is that all his videos are refuting his 15-year-old cousin, because his 15-year-old cousin, this is a grown man, but his cousin who's 15 doesn't believe that he's a Mahdi. So all his videos are refuting his cousin. He's not talking to the ummah. He's not. I think when the Mahdi comes out, he's going to have bigger issues than a 15-year-old. The Mahdi is out, he has a YouTube channel, and he doesn't help with all the calamities that are happening for the ummah. He just has to convince a 15-year-old that he is the Mahdi. And there are others from all around the world, you know, all around the world. Anyways, you have to fit all the descriptions. One speaker once said that the Dajjal is a television screen. Why? And bear with me, I know I've used this example a lot. He said that the Dajjal is the TV screen because, number one, the Prophet ﷺ said it enters into every home. So there's a TV screen in every home. So khalas, that's one. Two, sometimes four, huh? That's a good point. Sometimes three, four TVs in each home. Two, he said it's one-eyed. And the TV screen is one eye. See how I'm pushing it? It's not even an eye. And a'war means one eye works, the other doesn't work. So the TV is just one. It's not like a broken one. They don't sell you a broken one with a good one. You put them next to each other, right? Then the other thing is, it says that, the other thing he said, that it's called a Dajjal because he's lying. And what do you see on television? Lies all the time. And we know that. And we know that. So, you know, you see, you watch the news, oh, they're lying. You watch the commercial, they're lying. I know I said this before, but I love it. When you watch the sandwich commercial, everything falls on top of each other, slow motion. And it spins, and the lettuce is always sweaty, kida. And the meat falls, barraha, and the water spills, kida. When you go by, it's like, kida. Someone just stepped on it. Did you make this with your foot? Just stepped on it, and something flat, and that's the one in the picture? Yes, sir. Okay. So he said it's lying all the time, so the Dajjal is the TV screen. Yani Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam describes a man, tells you the height, and the hair and the forehead and which eye, and tells you he looks like Ibn Qatan, and then you tell me it's the TV, because the TV lies and the Dajjal lies. The TV has one eye, the TV is one screen, and the TV is in every home, the Dajjal enters every home. Okay. طيب, what about the other descriptions? We said that the Dajjal in the hadith mentioned, the Prophet mentioned, he cannot enter Mecca or Medina. And that's why when you went to Hajj and Umrah, and you went to your room in the hotel, there was no TV, because the Dajjal can't enter. No, there was a TV, and the TV screens all over Mecca and Medina. So doesn't make sense. The Dajjal cuts a man in half. They still haven't made a TV that'll cut a man in half. And if they make it, don't buy it when the guy says that. And also, it can also cut you in half. But okay, show me another model, please. Anyways, has to fit all the descriptions. Can't just take half of them and say, khalas, here. Oh, okay. Now, the fact that something is one of the signs before the Day of Judgment, it doesn't make it a bad thing. So this actually happened to me in class. Someone came to me, and he said, I don't understand why those Arabs keep building skyscrapers. And this is one of the signs before the Day of Judgment. يعني what are you, اتقوا الله, you're bringing the Day of Judgment closer. Why are you keep building these structures? This is one of the signs. So why do they keep doing that? And of course the answer is that it is not haram. And the fact that it's one of the signs doesn't make it a bad thing. Not every sign before the Day of Judgment is a bad sign. يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said before the day towards the end of time, a believer will hardly see a dream except it comes true. Is that a good or bad thing? It's a very good thing. Believers, the dreams will come true. So that's one of the signs, and it's not a bad thing at all. Towards the end, of, you know, or the Arabs competing in the construction of tall buildings, it's just one of the signs. It's neither bad nor good. Building making a building is mubah, it's permissible. It's not bad nor good. Towards the end of time, there will be a lot more women than men. It depends. Is that good or bad? I think if you're single, you're thinking, okay, that's good. And if you're married, you're like, okay, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. All right, anyways. So not everything is evil because it's from the signs of the Day of Judgment. We've got like 4 minutes. What's interesting is that when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions a sign, okay, we cannot link it to something or a specific event that took place, or we say this is it for sure, unless we said it matches all the signs. And then the other thing is that, you know, I'll give you an example. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned a fire that will erupt in Hijaz. And this actually did happen. It was a volcano that erupted. And anyone who's been to Medina or read the Sirah, you know that the Medina is in a volcanic area. That's why they had the Harra, Harrat Rahat and Harrat Khaybar, which were areas of jagged, rough volcanic rock on the sides of the city. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ only dug one khandaq, one trench, because the Harrat were protecting the sides, and then Banu Qurayza had a pact with the Prophet ﷺ, so they were protecting the back, and now just one trench in the front. Anyways, the point is, we know it was a volcanic area. So, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned a fire that will erupt in Hijaz, and its flames will be seen as far as Busra, not Al-Basra, because Al-Basra didn't exist at that time. But Busra is a city in Al-Sham, it's about 100 kilometers away, and literally, when that fire broke out, or the volcano erupted, people in Busra actually saw the flames. And they said its flames will be reflected on the necks of camels in Busra. So if you're sitting at a campfire, you see your camel, the neck glowing a little bit, like what's going on? You look that way, you see a fire, that was it. So, and poets wrote about it, and people went and made istighfar and tawbah and so on and so forth. So we know this event took place. And despite that, even then some scholars say it could still happen another time. So, and that's one of the things about the minor signs, is that they'll be repeated more, some of them will be repeated more than once, some of them intensify as time goes on. So inshallah, what we're going to do next time, we're going to look at the difference between the major and minor signs before the Day of Judgment. And we're going to look at some, or at least a few, just like two or three of the minor signs, and then primarily focus on the major signs. But one of the minor signs I want to mention are three trials that occur, and one of them is a trial that will not leave anyone on earth except that it would affect them, either directly or indirectly. So could that be COVID-19? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We'll look at it next time. Sallallahu alaihi wa Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you again to Aisha, Azim, Saif, Zaid again, and Arij and everybody else who's watching online, and the completely sold out and packed audience we have right here at Click. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.